Okay, I want to welcome everybody to the PEAS CAT meeting today. We appreciate you joining us. We are going to go ahead and do welcome and introductions, and we'll move on from the agenda that you see on the screen as soon as that is done. So I'll go ahead and start. I'll start with Andrea.
Hi, Andrea Amico from Portsmouth, New Hampshire, PEAS CAT member and co-founder of Testing for PEAS.
Thank you. Karen Anderson. I see she's trying to talk. Maybe you're on mute. Okay. So she's having difficulties. So Karen Anderson's on the call. She's waving. Thank you. Lindsay Carmichael let me know she would not be able to attend. Michelle?
Hi, can you hear me okay?
We can.
Wonderful. Michelle Dalton, CAT member and co-founder of Testing for PEAS, and I'm from Durham, New Hampshire.
Thank you. Elena?
Hi, my name is Elaine Davis. I'm a CAT member and co-founder of Testing for PEAS, and I worked on Portsmouth at PEAS.
Thank you. Rich?
Hi, Rich Diefenthema, Portsmouth, New Hampshire, former chairman of the CAB committee, now member of the CAP.
Thank you. Do we have Senator Martha Fuller Clark on? Don't believe so. Robert Harbison, Cliff Lazenby, and Tony McClellan let me know they were not going to be on. Is Russell on?
Yes, Russell Osgood. I'm with the Portsmouth Fire Department representing them on their CAP. Thanks.
Thank you. And Joe Ryan also let me know he was not going to be on tonight. Is Jared on? Okay. Mark Sullivan? And Shelley Vetter?
Hi, yep, Shelley Vetter, a member of the CAP and owner of Discovery Child Enrichment Center.
Thank you. Dr. Kerrigan? Okay. Dr. Durant?
Yeah, hi, I'm John Durant. I'm a civil and environmental engineering faculty at Tufts University.
Thank you. Dr. Shader?
Hi there, this is Laurel Shader from Silent Spring Institute.
Thank you. And I want to take a moment before we move on to our ATSDR staff to say welcome and goodbye. We have two people that are, one's joining and one's leaving. Neither one of them are on the call, but I did want to say welcome to Tony McClellan, who's a member of the City of Portsmouth Health Department. And a big old thank you to Stephanie Shaheen, who has been a CAT member, I think, from the very beginning. So we just wanted to make those acknowledgments before we moved on. So with that, let's move on to ATSDR staff. I'm just going to call on you as I have written you down. Brad?
Hello, this is Brad Goodwin. I am the Deputy Director for ATSDR's Office of Community Health and Hazard Assessment. I'm also the lead for our exposure assessment project.
Thank you. And Pam Whiten?
Hi, I'm Pam Whiten. I'm with NCHATSDR's Office of Communication, helping with the Zoom webinar.
Thank you. Frank Beauvais?
Yeah, I'm Frank Beauvais. I'm the co-PI on the PEAS study.
You, Tara?
I'm Tara Summers. I'm with ATSDR Region 1.
Thank you. Kim Dills?
Hi, Kim Dills. I'm Congressional Affairs Lead in the Policy Office for NCH and ATSDR.
Thank you. Lori Lonnie?
Hi, I am the PFAS Communication Lead.
Thank you. And Megan?
Hi, Megan Weems, the Program Manager for the Multisite Study.
Thank you. Marion?
Marion Pavu, co-PI on PEAS and Technology.
Thank you. And Dr. Bricey? Dr. Bricey, you're on mute.
So I'm the director of ATSDR and the National Center for Environmental Health.
Thank you. And our contractors, I'll start with Danielle.
I am Danielle Hunt, study director.
Thank you. And Zuha?
Hi, I'm Zuha. I am the project manager for the PEAS study.
Thank you. And Kate? Kate?
I'm Kate Derosier. I am the communication and community engagement task lead.
Thank you. And last but not least, Colonel Holyfield.
Hey, good evening. My name is Colonel Freeman Holyfield. I'm from the Air Force Secretariat.
Thank you. Did I miss anybody on the call? All right. And we want to welcome our community members on the call as well. There'll be a time in the agenda coming up for questions from the audience. And so when we get to that part, Pam Whiten will let us know the directions on how to ask your questions. So until then, we will move on to, sorry, I want to move back. Are there any intros you want to, Dr. Bricey? Any remarks before we move on with the agenda?
No, I think we should just move on to it. So we're excited about, you know, being back in the field, and we're doing everything we can to keep the study on track. And so let's just move on to the agenda.
Perfect. So we are going to start with the action items from the last CAP meeting, which is, believe it or not, September of 2020, which is a while ago. We didn't have too many action items, so this should go pretty fast as well. The first action item was for ATSDR. ATSDR will share the exposure assessment site summaries with a CAP. And this was done on October 1st and December 3rd, respectively. October 1st was Massachusetts, West Virginia, Delaware, and Washington. And December 3rd was Texas. The next action item was for ATSDR as well. The CAP asked for an ATSDR to provide a more detailed summary of the exposure assessment results, i.e. presentation during the next virtual CAP meeting. And that is on our agenda for tonight. Brad Goodwin, Dr. Goodwin will be giving that as well. The next agenda item is next two are for DOD. And these, I'm gonna read them, but they were both answered via email on December 10th. The first one was a CAP asked if the blood test for DOD firefighters includes former firefighters in addition to current firefighters. And the second DOD question was the CAP asked the DOD to provide further clarification on using New Hampshire MCLs versus EPA MCLs for cleanup purposes. And again, those responses were sent on December 10th. Are there any questions on the action items? Okay, hearing none, let's move on to the PEAS study update. Pam, would you please pull up Lori's slides? And we'll get started with an update from Lori Lonnie as soon as those slides are pulled up. Okay, Lori, if you'd like to take it from here.
Yes, thanks. So I'm just going to give you a quick overview of where we are with communication and community outreach to continue our efforts on recruitment. So let's flip to the next slide. All right, so we have some new materials. One of them has been the new PEAS study animated video. Right now it is posted on the website and it's on YouTube, and also Senator Shaheed's office promoted it over the weekend. So, and we're interested in all of your help taking that and also posting it on your own pages or anywhere you can help us to amplify our message. And the same goes for some of our new social media posts. We've updated some of the, you've probably seen some of the social media posts, but we've updated them and we've branded them a little bit more. So we want to go ahead and if you can go ahead and help share those as well, that will be a big, big help. Also, we're working with the New Hampshire Department of Health, and hopefully they will be helping us to promote the study more through these social media posts and our videos. Also, we have some ambassador videos. We did not produce these, but the community members did, and we're going to, hopefully you'll be seeing those on YouTube and through the CAP network to really attract some more people to the study. In addition to that, we have a really great PSA going that Mark Sullivan created. He did a wonderful job, and it is running on iHeart media stations right now. Also, it was 2 weeks ago, Kate DeRocher presented how to use social media. It's a PowerPoint, and we want to share it with all of the CAP members. I know not everybody is accustomed to using social media, so this will help you a little bit more. And also, if you do have questions, just reach out to me or Kate, and we'll help you go through any steps you need to go ahead and use different platforms to get the message out. Also, along with those same lines, besides new working with DHS New Hampshire, we are also working now with Nextdoor. We are still in the beginning stages of finding out what kind of help they can provide us, but if it goes well, they might be able to really target specific areas identified through the biomonitoring study. Also, thanks to our working group member, Andrea Amico, she has helped identify some media outlets who are willing to do interviews with community members and with Frank, so we can explain the importance of the PEAS study and the recruitment efforts and just a little bit more about PFAS. So we're still working with our agency to get that approved, but hopefully it won't take long because we'd like to see that take place this week. And on to the next slide. Another thing that we have going on with community outreach is working with the Tradeport businesses. The staff at the calls at the PEAS study office right now are contacting local businesses. We're trying to connect with them and encourage them to share information with all of their employees about how to participate in the study. And we're sharing a lot of our flyers with them so that they can also distribute them throughout the community. Also tomorrow we have a call with a network of healthcare providers in the area. We're hoping that they will be able to help us connect better to all the clinicians in the area so we can share with them all of our materials. We want to help educate them a little bit more about the PEAS study and get some posters and flyers there so that they're when they have patients come to the office, they can talk to the physicians a little bit more about PFAS and how they can participate. And also we're still answering questions and working with the Department of Health about how we could reconsent the biomonitoring participants. So those are some of the recruitment and communication activities that are going on. And we would encourage anybody also who is interested to join our working group. We have a standing hall every Thursday at noon. It's, you know, this is a really great chance for you to help brainstorm and give us your insight into the community to just make sure this study stays on target and we connect with more people. So thank you.
Thank you, Lori. Are there any questions for Lori?
This is Andrea. I have a question going back to the last slide. I don't know if you can go back one. There was an abbreviation or an acronym that I wasn't familiar with. I was just wondering, at the bottom, interviews, ATSDR SMEs. I wasn't sure what that stood for.
Oh, sorry. Subject matter experts. So Frank is our subject matter expert and Marion on our PEAS study.
Great. I just want to say too that I really, really liked the video. I thought it was really well done. So thank you for the efforts for that. And Senator Hassan's staff wrote back that they shared it today as well. And I also heard back from Congressman Chris Pappas. His staff told me Friday they were gonna share it. I'm not sure yet if it's been up, but I can circle back with them. And Congresswoman Custer, they said they would share it with their communications team. So I think we'll see some support from our congressional delegation to share that video on their social media pages, which is great because they have a lot of followers kind of from all over the state. So that's really well done. Thank you very much for your efforts on that.
Great, thank you for helping promote it more, Andrea. I really appreciate the effort you put into this.
Are there any other questions for Lori or the PEAS team? Okay, I'll ask AFT, did y'all have anything to contribute or anything to add as far as the peace study goes?
No, nothing beyond what Lori's presented. Thanks, Jamie.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, are there any other questions for peace study before we move on? Okay, so the next part is questions from the audience. Pam, would you, I'm not sure if we have anyone from the audience, but if we do, Pam, would you give instructions on how they can ask questions?
Sure, Jamie. So all of the attendees, you can raise your hand by clicking on the button on your Zoom screen, or you can also raise your hand by pressing Alt Y on a keyboard or *9 on your telephone, or you can put a note in the chat and let us know that you're wanting to talk, and then I can unmute you.
So I'm just going to pause for a few minutes to see if we have any community members on the call that would like to ask a question. We can probably also circle back, even though it's not on the agenda, circle back near the end for any questions as well, in case we have people join. So Pam, do you see any questions in the chat or raised hand?
I don't see any raised hands or anyone made any comments in the chat either.
Okay, so I'll circle back around just to give one more chance for any of those that might have questions that join. So we have a break. I suggest we don't take a break. We just got started. Let's move forward. I really do need to alter the agenda now that we're virtual. We've got this thing moving along. So we'll just keep going with the multi-site study update. Marian and Megan.
Hey, everyone. Just a quick update. We are undergoing an IRB amendment review right now. We're getting ready to submit another one, made a few changes to some of the informed consent documents. And so that should be happening soon. And then all of our site partners plan to initiate individual site work in late spring and summer, of course, depending on the COVID-19 situation in their local areas.
Thank you, Megan. Are there any questions for Megan on the multi-site study? Okay, you guys, this is going to be a record, I think. All right, let's move on then to the PEAS health consultation update. Tara, would you please give an update for us?
Sure. So Gary and Greg, they incorporated all the public comments, did about 70 of them, and it's in clearance for the private well. And they've also been working with the town of Newington officials to assist with reaching out to some former residents who may have been exposed and no longer were in Newington. So there was a request for that help. So they've been working with Newington on that as well, to talk about any past exposure concerns they have based on that data from the documents. So that's where we stand with documents.
Thanks, Tara. Any questions on the public health consultation?
Yes, what I can update on that is I have been working through the town of Newington doing title searches on all of the properties. It is about complete, so I'll be able to submit that in, going back probably about 30 years on each property that's changed hands. So that's almost done, and I'll be able to get that in by the end of the week.
Great, thanks, Karen. Andrea, did I see a question from you as well?
Yeah, I had a question, just kind of a general question about this process. So can you review how a community could maybe, I don't know if the right word is, self-refer ATSDR and wanting to have a public health consultation in their community? Because I feel like that question has come up from some other folks that I know across the country. And I just didn't know if someone could refresh all of us on how that process could happen.
Tara, you're on mute.
Sorry, I realize I muted again. Okay, sorry. It's the 2021 theme again. So that we usually call a petition, and any member of the public or community can petition ATSDR to work on a site. It can be
a formal letter if you want to write it, but sometimes it could be as informal as sending an email. You could send someone of the regional representatives, or we have a petition coordinator it could go to. And then what we do is we will, you know, look at the information that's available. Again, there has to be some data for us to use. That's the generally the biggest challenge with petitions that we get, is that there's really no environmental data for us to start working with. So yeah, you can send anyone my way and I'll tell them how to do it.
Okay, great. What do you mean by data, like water testing results for a town or?
Yeah, it depends on where you're being petitioned. The petition's asking for, in this case with PFAS, it would likely be water concentrations, but different sites around the country, you know, people ask us for air exposures or soil. So it just depends on what the site is.
Okay, thank you very much. And then actually, can I ask Karen a follow-up question, if that's okay? Sure. So Karen, you're researching private wells going back 30 years. Is that to inform people to, I'm just curious what the reasoning behind that is.
It was a request put to us to look up all past residents or property owners. So what I'm doing is taking each of the 42 properties and basically doing a title search all the way back, showing how long people lived in that property from owner to owner.
Then what are you doing with that information? Are you giving that to HSDR? Are you contacting the homeowners to let them know? Or
I'm not contacting them. I'm just submitting in all the information that I've collected. It's just going through deeds, going through the registry, looking at property transfers. The only thing I can't do is tenants. There's very few rental properties in Newington, but any of the properties, if they had been rented out, through privacy laws, I'm not even allowed to have the town clerk look at motor vehicle records attached to a property. So I can only do ownership.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions for Tara on health consultations? Okay, so next, Pam, if you wouldn't mind pulling up the exposure assessment presentation, I'll turn it over to Brad Goodwin.
All right. Well, thank you. Happy to be here to present some of the results from our PFAS exposure assessment so far. The process is still ongoing, so I'm just going to give you a status report for where we are now with some of the sites that we have results for. You can go to the next slide. I'm going to give a little bit of background on the exposure assessments and you know, what we can and can't learn from those, and then go into some of the findings from five sites where we do have data so far in Massachusetts, West Virginia, Delaware, Washington, and Texas. Give you a status update on the other sites where we don't have the results yet. Talk about the next steps, and then give you all an opportunity to ask any questions that you might have. Should we go to the next slide? And the next slide, this one has some animations that are gonna pop up. What I'm going to be talking about tonight is the exposure assessments. This is one piece of the activities that ATSDR is involved in. These are to assess PFAS exposure in communities near current or former military installations. And in doing this, we're trying to compare these PFAS levels that we're measuring in participants in these communities with the general population through our National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey that measures PFAS levels in the general population and try to identify any factors that might assess exposure. And so the exposure assessments include questionnaires to understand exposure, as well as blood and urine sample collection and analysis, and then some environmental measurements in tap water and indoor dust. It's not a health study. We're not able to connect these exposure levels to health effects. We're just assessing exposure. We have information about what was in the water, when that water was cleaned up in every case that where we're working. The water concentrations have been mitigated either through taking wells offline or putting in treatment systems. So we know how long ago the exposure stopped, what the levels were when people were being exposed. And now we're gonna have the the biomonitoring results to add into that. The next slide. Next piece of this work is the PEAS study. I'm not going to talk about that. You all know all of the details for what's going on there. And then next slide is the multi-site study that will expand on the science of the relationship between PFAS exposure and health outcomes. So these are just three pieces of the work. Again, what I'm going to be focused on here is the exposure assessments. So we'll go on to the next slide. Just a little bit of information about how we chose the exposure assessment sites. These were selected based on criteria from the National Defense Authorization Act. We considered sites that had known exposure to PFAS in drinking water, and they had to have concentrations of PFOA and PFOS combined above EPA's lifetime health advisory in drinking water to be eligible for consideration. They also had to be located near a current or former military base. And then we gathered as much other information as we could about the sites and tried to pick a range of locations, taking into account the type of water supply, the amount of PFAS that were measured in the water, the number of people served by the contaminated water, and then how long the exposure lasted. So we took all that information in and came up with a list of sites that we are conducting these exposure assessments. So we go to the next slide. Here's a map with the sites, and we have two sites here that are in green in Pennsylvania and New York that were pilot sites for a lot of the tools that we're using. Those exposure assessments were conducted by the state health departments in Pennsylvania and New York, and they used our PFAS exposure assessment technical tools. And we learned a lot from what they were able to do. And we're using mostly the same procedures in the exposure assessments that ATSDR is running at these eight additional sites. And they are all across the country. And again, I'm gonna be able to go into the results for some of those sites here tonight. Go to the next slide. Just a status on where we're at for the eight sites that we're running. We have three sites that we didn't complete the field work until after the COVID pandemic hit. Those are the sites in Alaska, Colorado, and New York. And we completed field work at those sites between August and October of 2020. And so those samples are still in the analysis phase. We haven't done any reporting back to communities. We're waiting to get the information from the labs to have any information to share there. So that's kind of the status for those three. We did complete our field work for five sites before we had to pause things. Those are the sites in Massachusetts, West Virginia, Delaware, Washington, and Texas. The first four of those we completed in 2019, and the Lubbock, Texas site we completed at the beginning of March for our data collection in March of 2020. So we got through all of those before we needed to pause things. The individual results for all of our participants there have been sent back to the people who participated, and we're in the process of developing the individual site reports for those sites now. Go to the next slide. Now I'm actually going to get into the results that we have from these first five sites. And I'm going to start with the site in Hampton County, Massachusetts. This is Westfield, Massachusetts, where we had a total of 459 people participate. We had a goal across the sites of 395 participants. It was based on some assumptions about what the distribution was of concentrations was going to look like. That was the goal for recruitment. Here we got 459, including 49 children from 247 different households. And the concentrations in the water in this community were just over 200 nanograms per liter or parts per trillion of PFOA and PFOS combined, and 170 nanograms per liter for PFHXS. And all of the mitigation activities in this community were completed in January of 2016. That's the date when the water system reduced the PFAS levels below EPA's lifetime health advisory. This water system had several wells. Some of them were contaminated, some were not. And working with that system, we identified the area north of the river here that's shaded in green as the area of interest for this exposure assessment. We can go to the next slide. And so here is presenting the geometric mean of the concentrations in our population from our Massachusetts site to the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, which is the general population survey that CDC has been doing, measuring PFAS since 1999. And so for PFOS, we were at 5.9 in Massachusetts compared to 4.7 in the general population, 4.7 for PFHXS compared to 1.2 in the general population, and then 1.9 compared to 1.6. All these are micrograms per liter for the general population and for our exposure assessment population. Now, I do want to mention a couple of things here, and while we're not necessarily comparing all of these on one slide, the populations in each of these groups are very different in terms of the demographics. We know that in general, older people tend to have higher concentrations of PFAS in their blood. And so we want to make sure that we can account for that when we do any comparison between these exposure assessment sites. And we're just presenting these one by one for now. We also know that there are a different amount of time between when the water was cleaned up and when we got out into each of the communities, and there were different concentrations in the water. And so we're going to be writing a final report that compiles the information from all of these sites. And at that point, we'll be able to make those comparisons, but we're not at the point yet where we're comfortable doing that because of those differences. So move on to the next slide here. I am gonna present a brief comparison to some other studies, and specifically because we have some data that was conducted in Portsmouth, New Hampshire on this slide. So here we have an occupational study. These are the PFOS concentrations. An occupational study of manufacturing workers in Alabama, some sites with exposed communities, as well as NHANES comparisons, both the 1999-2000, so the first year that NHANES measured PFAS in serum, and the 2015-2016 NHANES data. And Portsmouth is among these exposed communities here. You see for PFOS, the level in Portsmouth was 8.6, and for our Hampton County, Massachusetts site was at 5.9 for PFOS in micrograms per liter. I'm going to go through several of these relatively quickly for other species and for other sites, but I just want to put some context around this relative to the biomonitoring that's been done in Portsmouth. So we can go to the next slide. This is showing the same type of information, but for PFHXS, and here the Massachusetts EA site at 4.7, slightly higher than the 4.1 that was measured in Portsmouth that was reported in 2015. And then to the next slide is for PFOA, in the Massachusetts site at 1.9, in the Portsmouth site at 3.1 for PFOA. You're going to see really similar slides to that, just with each of the other exposure assessments highlighted in yellow as we go through the rest of the presentation. I'll be happy to take any questions about this at the end. We'll go to the next slide. These are the results from our West Virginia site in Berkeley County and the city of Martinsburg, where we had 275 people, including 28 children from 166 households. And the water was cleaned up here in May of 2016. We had PFOA and PFOS combined just over 100 parts per trillion, and PFHXS just over 70 parts per trillion in this community. This community was served by two separate water systems, but there was only one contaminated well. There's just an interconnection between the two where the county buys some of the water from the city. And so that's why we had two systems that were both getting water from that one well. Move on to the next slide. And in this community, again, we had PFOS at 5.1 micrograms per liter compared to 4.7 in the NHANES comparison group, and PFHXS at 2.9 compared to 1.2 in the NHANES group. But our PFOA concentration here in Berkeley County is actually slightly lower than what we saw in NHANES. And again, none of these have been age adjusted at this point. That will all happen in our individual site reports and our final report. Moving on to the next slide. Here again is the comparison of different sites where our West Virginia exposure assessment at 5.1 and the Portsmouth community at 8.6 for PFOS. Next slide. So the same information for PFHXS with Portsmouth at 4.1 and our West Virginia site at 2.9. We'll go to the next slide. For Newcastle, Delaware, we had 214 people participate, including 11 children from 134 households. Here again, we had two water systems, but they did have different wells in this case. One of the systems cleaned up in 2014 and one in 2016. There was a preliminary cleanup for both of them in 2014, but then there were additional wells found that were above EPA's health advisory in one of the systems, and that was cleaned up in 2016. And here we had higher concentrations in the water, and they differ between those two systems. You'll see how that translates as we move to the next slide to look at the results here. Go to the next slide. And so here for the PFOS, we're at 21.5 in our Delaware exposure assessment site compared to 4.7 in the general population, 20.1 for PFHXS compared to 1.2 in the general population, and 5 compared to 1.6 for PFOA. So certainly higher concentrations measured here than our first two sites. And as we go to the next slide, we'll see where these fall compared to some of the other communities with exposure, and Newcastle here at 21.5 compared to 8.6 in Portsmouth for PFOS. The next slide, 20.1 for PFHXS compared to the 4.1 in Portsmouth. And then onto the next slide, we have 5.0 for PFOA in Delaware compared to 3.1 in Portsmouth. We'll move on to the next site. It was in Spokane, Washington. We had 333 people, including 47 children from 168 households. The water here was cleaned up a little bit later than some of the other sites, and not until 2017. We had PFOA and PFOS combined at 1,500 parts per trillion, and PFHXS also at 1,500 parts per trillion. In this community, this was a single water system serving the entire city of Airway Heights. We'll move on to the next slide. And here the concentrations were the highest of the four that we've gone through so far. We had 72.9 micrograms per liter in our Washington exposure assessment site compared to 1.2 in the general population, 42.4 compared to 4.7 for PFOS, and 9.7 compared to 1.6 for PFOA. As we move on to the next slide, we'll see how these compare to Portsmouth, and here for PFOS, Spokane at 42.4 compared to 8.6. It is actually the highest of any of the exposed communities, but still much lower than occupational exposure levels. Move to the next slide. For PFHXS, we're at 72.9 again, the highest of these exposed communities, but lower than occupational, and then Portsmouth at 4.1. The next slide for PFOA at 9.7 in our Washington exposure assessment and 3.1 in Portsmouth. Go on to the next slide. The last site that we have results for right now is in Lubbock County, Texas. Just want to mention here, this is one of two sites that where we did exposure assessments that were for private wells. So the first four that I talked about were all municipal water systems. Our Texas site and Alaska sites are all private wells. So we have expect maybe a broader spread in concentrations because the concentrations in individual wells differ throughout the sample area, whereas with the municipal water systems, we may have had a couple of different water systems. We expect that the people who are all being served by those municipal systems are getting similar concentrations to one another. But here in Lubbock County, we had 214 people participate, including 24 children from 96 households. The dates here of the water mitigated by September of 2019. That's just the last date that we had any well sampling that was above EPA's lifetime health advisory. That was happening in phases here at this site. And again, these levels that we're reporting here are the maximum levels reported in any of the wells in this community, with PFOS just over 900 parts per trillion, PFOA at 3,900, and PFHXS just over 1,200. Move on to the next slide. You see the results here. We do have PFHXS at 6 compared to, I'm sorry, the number isn't showing up here. It's 1.2 for the general population. So 6 for our Lubbock County exposure assessment site, 1.2 for the general population. But for PFOS here in Lubbock County, we're actually lower than the general population, 4.2 to 4.7. And for PFOA, 2.2 compared to 1.6 for the results here. We'll move to the next slide. Again, here for PFOS, we show our Lubbock County site being the lowest of any of these exposed populations and even lower than the general population, with our Lubbock County site at 4.2 compared to 8.6 in Portsmouth. The next slide. This was the PFHXS, where we had 6.0 in Lubbock compared to 4.1 in Portsmouth. And then the next slide, we have 2.2 micrograms per liter for PFOA in Lubbock compared to 3.1 in Portsmouth. So we can go on to the next slide. At this point, we still have a fair amount of work in front of us, even though the field work is complete. We are going to be sending out our individual test results and sharing summary results similar to what I've shared here for these five sites with our remaining communities in Alaska, New York, and Colorado. We're also continuing to evaluate all of the data collected from the sites, including the biological data, environmental data, and our questionnaire data to better understand exposure in each of the communities, looking at things like occupational differences, age, gender, length of residency, environmental exposure, and several other questions that were included in our exposure questionnaire. We are writing individual reports for each of those sites that will present the findings, any associations that we found between the serum concentrations and any of our exposure questions or our environmental measurements, as well as a final report combining the findings from all of the sites that will be able to do some of the comparisons that I know people are all going to be really interested in. What are the differences between the sites? What are the factors for a given site that really control the measurements of PFAS in the blood? And we're going to be holding information sessions to talk with community members in each of the communities as well, and share the findings from the individual site report, as well as answer any questions that they might have. can go to the next slide. So I'll pause, I'll stop here, and I'm happy to take questions. Hopefully this was informative for the group. I know that there are probably gonna be some questions that we're just not at the point where we can answer yet, where we're looking at the specific associations between any of the exposure factors or the exposure questions and these serum concentrations. But as the reports are developed and released, that's when we'll have answers. And if it's appropriate, I'm happy to come back or have another person come back at some point in the future to present that type of information, because I know you all may be interested in that as well. Thank you for your attention. I'll take any questions.
Thanks, Brad. Appreciate it. Any questions for Brad?
I have one about sites. All those sites, AFFF foam, was that the source, or is there other sources?
Yeah, the expectation for all of these sites is that AFFF is at least a contributing source. There may be other sources in addition, but we, in our site selection, we were trying to ensure that all of the sites were AFFF as one exposure.
I have a few questions. First of all, thank you very much. That was very informative. I really appreciated the graphs and that you included Portsmouth in there. It helped make it relevant to our community as well. So I really appreciate your presentation. I don't know if you said this or not, but do you have a timeline of when? So it sounds like all the individual, you said the field work is done. You're working on still individual reports, and then there'll be a final report. Do you have a timeline of when we can expect the final report from all of this work?
Yeah, you know, pre-COVID, our timeline was to try and get that by September of 2021. I think that we're probably gonna be delayed from that. Our field work was delayed by about 6 months due to COVID, and our lab reporting is gonna be delayed somewhat longer than 6 months because of some diminished capacity to analyze samples at the lab. So I don't have a firm timeline, but it's going to be more than 6 months before we have that final report.
Okay, thank you. I'm just curious if you can tell us how communities that have had this done and have received the results yet, how are they reacting to this information? Are you getting a lot of concern from people? Are you getting questions from local healthcare providers? I'm just curious how the results of this, how it's going over in the communities.
So I will say that we haven't had a ton of questions related to the results. We have had some. People have certainly been interested. We've tried to provide some information along with this. We've been providing presentations for healthcare providers in the area because we are encouraging people to talk to their doctors about these results if they have questions. Now, some of that may be that the results reporting got started in May, and there have been a lot of other things on people's minds, a lot of other things that local health departments and physicians have been dealing with since then. So I don't know what the response would have been if these results would have started going out pre-COVID. But I will say that it hasn't been, we haven't been getting flooded with questions. We've been getting a steady trickle, but I think that other more pressing concerns have jumped to the top of mind. It's my interpretation of that. That's kind of the general picture. I will say that the levels of engagement in the communities have differed pretty widely, that we've had some communities beforehand that were very engaged. We had lots of people interested. We were able to recruit, and some communities that were less engaged. And it was more of a challenge to raise awareness of the work. And then we haven't had as much interaction in those communities afterwards.
Okay, great, thank you. A couple other questions. So you said something about older adults having higher levels of PFAS. I'm just curious, you did have children participate in the study, but obviously not large numbers of children, but I'm just curious. I know, at least from my own personal experience, my kids' levels, or my daughter, she had really high levels even compared to the average at Pease. So I'm just curious if you are also seeing, you know, children with more elevated levels. You had mentioned older adults. I'm just curious if you're seeing higher levels in children.
Yeah, so the numbers of children at each of the sites have been relatively small. And so it's been difficult to do a really robust analysis for children on a site-by-site basis. That is something that we hope that by pooling the children from across the sites, that we'll be able to have some more, a larger data set to draw conclusions from, and that would be included in the final report, but I don't have anything to share on that just yet.
Okay, great. Two more questions. So in terms of recruitment, do you have any strategies that you can share with us about how, you know, you were, it sounds like you were recruiting during the pandemic, right? You got some people to give samples. So was there anything that worked really well at any of these sites or didn't work well that you can share with us as we struggle to also get recruitment, getting people to sign up?
I don't have any kind of magic bullets for recruitment during the pandemic. I will say that one of the communities that we were recruiting in during the pandemic, we had a really, really hard time. And we're not going to have very many participants there in one of those final three sites. We tried to do the same types of things that we had done before, but they, you know, I think that community was probably going to be one of the harder ones, and the pandemic just made it even harder. The communities, I think, that we did have relatively good luck in recruiting from during the pandemic were the ones that were more engaged ahead of time, and the ones that had better awareness of the issue. And so, you know, getting out and just being limited in how much we could go door to door and have those in-person interactions was certainly a learning experience. And I see Dr. Bricey has raised his hand.
Brad, maybe you could say a few words about the difference here. That we try to get a representative sample here. So we identified, you know, homes to reach out to rather than just trying to advertising for anybody who wants to come down and participate, which is kind of how we're working in Pease. So the things that worked in exposure assessments are not necessarily going to translate into the Pease recruitment, therefore.
That's correct. So, in some of our communities that are smaller, like our Alaska community, for example, we needed to invite everyone from the community to try and get to our potential sample size. But in most of the communities, we identified households randomly ahead of time and then targeted those households for participation. So we weren't able to accept volunteers from outside of that group of pre-selected households. We did try and select more households than we originally intended to try and get higher participation numbers, but it wasn't the same type of recruitment where anyone in the area was eligible to participate. So we did go out with targeted mailings, targeted door-to-door knocking, getting phone numbers and making phone calls, but we had kind of a limited pool of addresses to do that.
No, that's a good point for sure. I guess my last question would just be, what do you plan to do with this information when everything is all said and done? Like, how do you anticipate this will inform future work or future plans that ATSDR has now that you have all this exposure assessment data? You know, are you thinking about next steps or anything that this might contribute to in the future?
I mean, I think we're looking forward to figuring out whether there are any environmental factors or answers to exposure questions that jump out as predictors of concentrations of PFAS in blood, looking at the mixtures of PFAS in blood and understanding how that differs from site to site, from location to location, to know if there are any ways to kind of predict where we might expect more exposure or less, and trying to lead this into the health study at Pease and the multi-site study to share that information so that we can have that better understanding of these exposures and identify whether there's anything else going on there. I don't know, Pat, it looked like you wanted to say something there too.
Andre, we've talked about this before, the challenges of offering bomb monitoring to anybody who wants it. And just, the lack of resources and the lack of, medical insurance to pay for it to get that done. And so what we're hoping to do is by doing this in a systematic way and looking at all these factors that Brad's talked about, has been able to inform people who didn't get their blood sample something about what their PFAS levels might be. So everybody should benefit from that, whether they participated or not, because we're trying to be systematic and trying to understand these determinants. So that'll help inform people whether they got their blood sample or not. And by doing it this way, we can also come back in time and we can look and see how things change over time. And we can also look at what the determinants of high exposure are and then target those people have those conditions maybe for some more detailed work as well going forward. So this could inform future health studies, it could inform future biomonitoring studies, and it'll also serve the public health function of informing the community about what the spectrum of exposures are and what's unique about those exposures. So you saw from Brad's discussion that there are profiles of these PFAS compounds that are not the same across all these sites. That's telling us something. And we got to figure out what that's telling us, because that could mean there might be something else going on at sites that have a different profile. And so we're going to follow up on all that. And so this is not the end of the story for us.
I have a question.
So Rich, can I hold you for a second? I see John Durant's hand has been raised for just a minute. I'll get to you next, Rich. Okay. Thank you.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great, thanks. So I just had a question about the concentrations reporting in the water samples. Could you just comment a little bit about where they came from? Are these averages over time, or are these the samples that were collected as close as possible to when the blood samples were drawn? What's the relationship there?
So the water concentrations that I had reported on the slides were the maximum concentrations that were measured in each of these communities before any cleanup happened.
I see. So these weren't individualized water samples. These were just community water samples.
Yes. We did water sampling from a subset of the participants in the exposure assessment as part of the work. But the samples that we went out collect were all post cleanup. And so we weren't expecting to see high levels of PFAS and that's what we found, that the cleanup had largely been effective.
But Brad, most of the data we used came from the EPA and through the unregulated contaminant monitoring rule data, is that true?
Most of it came from EPA. DOD shared some data with us as well, especially for the private well communities and for some of the smaller systems where they had done some sampling as well.
Thank you, Brad. John, did you have any follow-up questions?
Thank you.
Okay, wonderful. Rich?
Yes, I had just a bureaucratic question, I guess. I noticed there's a disclaimer on the bottom here that says the conclusions of the report are of the authors and not necessarily that of CDC and the ACSDR. Does this report not go through the clearance process of the CDC and ACSDR before it's released? And why would it not be an official document of those agencies?
So that disclaimer has to go on all of our presentations here. Pat or Jamie, do you want to address when that comes off in the future?
Yeah, when we have a final report that has been cleared and peer reviewed, at that point we'll stand behind it. But for now, this is all still
preliminary, and that's a standard boilerplate language that CDC asks us to put on stuff. But I assure you, we stand behind these results. But they aren't final yet, and you know, our final story will be in the approved report that gets peer reviewed and published on our website, you know, when we're all said and done.
Thank you. Laurel.
Hi, thanks for your presentation, Brad. I was curious, beyond the three PFAS compounds you presented on, are there others that were present at high levels in the water and that were frequently found in the water? I'm thinking of pharmacokinetic modeling, and that your data set could be helpful for other compounds beyond just these three.
Yeah, in most cases, we didn't have sampling for other compounds in the water. In a lot of cases, or in some, we didn't even have it for PFHXS. We don't have a lot of information on what other PFAS were in the water, but nothing else that had been monitored for and had jumped out.
And how about in the blood data? Were there others that showed up frequently in any of the communities?
There were other things that were detected. Had some of those on the slides. Most of them were detected at about the same levels as in the general population. Things like PFNA, PFDA, the longer chain legacy compounds.
Thank you, Laurel. Any other questions for Brad on exposure assessment?
Jamie, I have a couple more. Actually, I don't know if this is more of a question for Dr. Bricey, but you had said something about how not everyone can participate in this program and that hopefully this data will help inform others. Do you expect, or I don't know if expect is the right word, but do you think that potentially out of this work that some type of calculator or something could be used to help communities that don't have access to blood testing but know their PFAS levels? Are you expecting that from this work, like some tool, calculator or tool like that could be developed to help impacted community members determine what their levels might be?
So we probably haven't used that word yet, but I think that's exactly what we're thinking of doing. Try to come up with some criteria that will allow people to figure out where they would fit on the spectrum of data. Okay.
All right, great, thanks. And then in terms of, you know, seeing the different profiles, or I'm not sure how you labeled it, but obviously varying levels of different PFAS at different sites, even though they're all AFFF, have you been able to kind of match that with any type of known AFFF mixtures? Do you have access to like what was in different AFFF so you can try to compare what's in the blood of these communities versus what was in the foam that was maybe used you know, contaminated their water?
So we do know that there are different formulations in the AFFF. What we don't know is which ones were used at what locations and in what proportions and at what times. So that's the information that would be pretty hard to get there than some, they all have different half-lives in the body. And so trying to get to recreate, you know, that from what we have, I think would be pretty difficult. We are going to be looking at the mixtures of the PFAS that were measured in the blood at the different sites, and we may be able to, you know, say, you know, for example, at the Texas site that didn't have much PFOS compared to the other species, that there may have been something different about the AFFF that was used there. But we're also going to have to take into account how long it has been, because you know, the half-life for PFHXS is likely the longest of these. So it may be an indicator of the time since the exposure was happening, in addition to the mixture of what types of compounds were there.
But Andrea, that's a great question. And as we learn more like this, we will go back to the DOD and see if they can get us any information. They haven't been able to yet because it's these old purchase records, you know, and how far back do they have them? And in many cases, they don't know what exactly the profile of chemicals are. They bid this stuff out for a performance specification, not necessarily for a a compositional specification. So they might not have that information. But I also caution you that it might not be just that there's different PFAS formulations of AFFF. There could be other things here that are not AFFF. You know, there's lots of industrial uses for these chemicals, and these military bases are complex. In many cases, have industrial-like activities, and sometimes there's industries around the military bases. So there could be other sources of PFAS in the water that are not AFFF related as well, which is something else we're considering.
I mean, is that something, was part of this process a questionnaire where you asked those questions about, are there local landfills or factories or whatever?
Well, we're doing a big mapping exercise. We're trying to look at what we think the industries are around the sites, see if we can get some clues from that. EPA has a big database of PFAS suspected releasing sites that we're tapping into as well. That's all stuff that we're looking at.
Thank you. I want to jump to Elena.
Hi, I was actually wondering, and it's actually piggybacking on what Dr. Bricey was talking about. Was any data collected related to what types of areas use the PFAS chemicals, like similar to PEAS, where we had a fire training area and, you know, we had some releases due to a plane crash and things like that. Is any of that data collected at any of these exposure sites so that you can maybe correlate that to maybe some of the levels in the water or the blood later on if that can be analyzed?
We didn't collect that as part of this process. We do have some information about plane crashes in certain areas or spills at sites. But in a lot of cases, the exposure is likely due to just prolonged use in training. But there are a couple of locations that have more site-specific events.
Okay, thank you, Laurel.
Yeah, I had one more question for Brad. I'm trying to remember, and maybe you mentioned this, but for the exposure assessments, were there other household measurements like dust or anything getting at other exposures? I seem to remember like 10% of houses had some other exposure measures.
Yeah,
for about the timeline for those and what you might learn, especially for communities, you know, where water mitigation has been in place for a while and more recent exposures might be more related in part to consumer products or other sources of exposure.
Yeah, we did do indoor dust and tap water measurements. We tried to get it from 10% of the households at each site. The indoor dust data are somewhat exploratory. There aren't good comparison values, so we're trying to evaluate those data. I think we're trying to understand what that might mean in terms of exposure. We did have some questions getting at other types of exposure sources or use of some consumer products, some diet related questions. And we're also working with EPA on a follow-on project to try and get a little bit more information about those types of things.
That's great to know. Will that questionnaire that was used be shared with the multi-site study teams?
Yeah, the questionnaire is certainly available to the multi-site study teams. It's based on the questionnaire in our PFAS exposure assessment technical tools. And I think that the multi-site folks are all aware of the questionnaire that we had. And as we get more results, we can share with them if there were any specific questions that were particularly useful or places where we feel like it might have been nice to have some additional information.
Great, thanks.
Thank you. Any more questions for Brad on exposure assessment? Okay, I'm just making sure there's no hand raised one last time. Okay, thank you, Brad. We appreciate your time tonight. A great presentation. You. Okay, I do want to circle back around and make sure we see if we have any questions from the audience. So if you are in the audience and you have a question, if you could type in the chat or raise your hand. We'll be happy to wait a few seconds to see if we have any questions. And if we don't, that's okay too. I just wanted to give you the one more opportunity. Okay, so I'm seeing none again. So we'll just move on and I'll keep an eye on that to see if anybody changes their mind. The next thing we have up is CAP concerns. Is there any concerns the CAP members would like to raise that we haven't already covered on the agenda?
Yep, this is Andrea. I just was wondering, I know we've talked over the last year about the intersection of PFAS and COVID, which I think is a very relevant issue. And I was wondering if someone from ATSDR could give us an update in terms of where you may be at looking at how those two things intersect. And, you know, I think particularly around like vaccines and, you know, I think I've read things in the some articles about there's been some mention of potentially PFAS impacted communities getting a third vaccine. You know, the current vaccines require two, just because we know that PFAS can impact immune function. And so I was hoping ATSDR could give us an update on their work looking at PFAS and COVID and any thoughts they have around vaccinations and effectiveness of vaccinations and any future work that may be going into looking at that as the country continues to roll out mass vaccinations in all the states.
You want me to take that on, Jamie?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, so way back when this started, you guys asked us to look into it. And at that point, we started having discussions with Philippe Grandjean about his work before he published it. And we started talking to the COVID team at CDC and HHS at the time. And what we started doing is a couple studies where we're looking at the first question, which is what's the relationship between PFAS and your likelihood of getting the disease or severity of the disease. And we're doing that taking advantage of a couple opportunities. So the first opportunity is there's a study that's being done at CDC to look at healthcare providers, first responders, and COVID-19. Obviously, that's a high impact group for COVID-19. And we've talked to them and we've agreed that we will add some PFAS measurements to the blood work that they're doing. So they'll have a lot of detail about the exposures and the disease profile of these people. And so we'll be in a position once our laboratory gets up and running again and we get the blood samples from the study to look and see if there's a relationship between their disease experience and PFAS levels. So that's the first, that was probably the most readily available opportunity we had to add some PFAS work to the COVID response. Now, the second thing we're looking at now, this is a little bit more developmental at this point, is you know, we have, while the first study, we had all this disease, COVID disease work done, and we added PFAS to it. We have all these people, we know a lot about PFAS, but we don't know a lot about their COVID disease experience. And so we're developing a questionnaire and we're looking for permission to submit it. And the same permission that we've always talked about is what we have to go through for that. And we hope to send that a questionnaire around to the people who we've recruited for our studies and ask them about their COVID disease experience. Now, that's limitation is that it's all going to be self-reported data. But we know we'll have a lot of people with very high PFAS levels. We're not quite sure in the first responder cohort that I mentioned in the first study, what the range of PFAS exposures are going to be in these people. So if they all have low PFAS, that's not going to be a very informative study. On the other hand, we have this group where we have a lot of range of exposure, including some very high exposures, but what we're limited in right now is just asking them about their COVID disease experience. So those are two things that we're doing right now. The first one, we already have permission to do, we've identified resources to do. We're waiting to get the blood and we're waiting to free up our lab who could do it. The second one, we're developing a questionnaire and we're getting permissions in place to get that one in the field. Now, the third question is gonna be tougher right now. So, you know, the country right now is aggressively putting the vaccines out. And quite frankly, we've backed off a bit because the CDC staff right now is very stressed and trying to get the vaccine out in the first place. But as soon as things get a little relaxed, we're going to talk to them about opportunities to think about a way we can look at vaccine efficacy at PFAS levels. So right now, there is no plans to do anything different for people who have high PFAS levels. Remembering, even in a community that's got high levels in the water, you can have people who have very low PFAS and very high PFAS in the community. So just being in an area that's got contaminated water doesn't necessarily tell you exactly what your PFAS levels are going forward. So that'll be a bigger issue to look forward to. It's something to look into. We're figuring out, you know, what the best way to do that is going forward. But unfortunately, we're trying to, you know, build the bus as the bus is driving down the road in this case. And so that's a bit of a challenge for us.
Great, thank you. So I would say to the last point, you know, I certainly understand CDC being stressed and trying to roll out the vaccines, but I also think wanting to know if the vaccines are effective is, I think, critically important right now, because I think a lot of people are putting a lot of faith in the vaccines and helping us to get back to normal. So if we find that, or if we don't look to see if they're effective, especially in communities that we know have PFAS exposure, and they may not be as effective, I mean, that to me is concerning as we try to get out of this pandemic and move back towards somewhat normalcy in our lives. So I understand, I'm appreciative that you're looking for opportunities. I think my response would be that I think that needs to have a sense of urgency on it right now in terms of.
So the number one, first order issue they're dealing with right now in terms of vaccine is whether it's efficacious against all these variants that are emerging. Mm-hmm. And so they're focusing on that, with a lot of urgency right now. So for obvious reasons right now. So our disease specialists, infectious disease specialists are most worried about that. And they would see the PFAS work as maybe be secondary to something like that going forward. But I assure you, we're gonna do everything we can within the resources we have and the constraints we have to mount an effective public health response.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Going back to your first point about studying healthcare, studying like PFAS levels in healthcare workers that have had COVID, a few questions that I have is, do you know, are these first responders, are they going to be representative of the nation, or are they from a certain area of the nation?
Oh, they're from a certain area. Can anybody remind me? I'm thinking they're from the desert Southwest.
Rachel, do you have any information?
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'm sorry to be joining late, but I can help with that question. The participants for the study that we'll be doing the PFAS sub-study for is recruiting participants from a number of sites across the country. The first responder portion of the study that's specifically recruiting firefighters will be coming largely from Arizona.
Okay. Do you know how many people are part of that study?
Don't have that number off the top of my head, but I can find out for you.
Okay. And then lastly, is there a timeline as to when you think that you would be able to test this blood for PFAS and take a look at, you know, the relationship between their COVID disease and their PFAS levels? And are you expecting to write a report on that? Like, how are we going to be informed of the results of this information?
Pat, do you want to take that?
Yeah. I'm not sure what the timeline is exactly. The two hurdles we have to overcome are, first of all, so right now the blood work that's being collected as a part of this study is looking at some vaccine efficacy issues. And so there might actually be an opportunity here, but we don't want to commit to that. But, and then our laboratory is right now on very limited staff going forward. And so it's hard to commit to when the lab will be able to do the work. It'll be in the top of the list when they get back in there going forward. And then we will write a report and we'll publish it. I'm not quite sure what the venue will be, but this might be a perfect article for the MMWR, which is the CDC's flagship publication opportunity. And rest assured that we will let all our community engagement groups aware of the results when it comes out. We will not quietly release those results.
Okay, thank you. My final question is around the second point where you're sending out questionnaires. Is that to exposure assessment sites only? Is that the multi-site study sites, you know, only, or is that all of them? Like where are the questionnaires going?
I believe it's our exposure assessment sites. Because we already have all those, we already have all that work in hand, and those are people we recruited. The way we set up the multi-site study is each site is essentially responsible for their own work. And they haven't recruited anybody yet. So right now we have a nice pool of people that we can send a questionnaire to, on the order of a couple thousand, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, we're thinking the ceiling is probably somewhere around 4,000 at this point.
All right, are there any other questions or concerns before we wrap up the meeting? Okay, last chance. Okay, guys. Oh,
thanks everybody.
Andrea, I see a question.
Sorry. I just want to talk about the PEAS study in terms of, do we have a target date in mind? I know, obviously, we paused for a while, we've reopened, and recruitment has been slow. I know there's never been like a final date. It's just been like, let's try to get those numbers that we need. But has anyone given any thought to a final date, or because we're in the pandemic, we can just assume that it's going to remain open and, you know, hopefully we can start ramping up even more efforts to get people in when, you know, it's a little bit safer to do so, or not that it's not safe now, but when we see the numbers continue to trend down. So I'm just curious, do we have like a certain date in mind?
Frank, do you want to take that, or would you like?
I am not aware of what it is. Yeah.
Yeah, we're exploring opportunities to extend recruitment. That's what I can say right now.
So there is no official date you can give us that you could say, regardless of you hitting your numbers, this date the study closes.
Not right now.
Okay, that's very reassuring to hear. And, you know, again, there's things that we're doing now to work on recruitment, but it's tough right now. You know, it's really tough. So I'm reassured to hear that there's no final date and that we can continue to work to get people in and hopefully see better recruitment as things settle down more. So thank you.
We're fully focused on recruitment at this point and how we can increase that in the months coming up as well. Okay, any other questions? All right. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate your time on a Monday. Thank you. We'll talk soon. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks.